Welcome viewers, pro-theologist in the office here on the Central Coast, New South Wales, Australia. We're looking at Romans chapter 7. I'll take you in there now, again, just so you don't think I'm hiding. Here I am. G'day viewers, bit of a rough nut, but it's all right. There's my credentials. You can take it or leave it. It's totally up to you. I don't care. 20 or 30 years of it, since left the ministry, got a bit too much for me, demons chasing me for years, I wanted to get away from all that, which I did. Now I'm going to teach you how the sinful nature gets power over us and we don't even know it, got no clue of it, but it does. Just some quick verses. Sin, seizing opportunity through the commandment. The simple definition for commandments, God's commandments, the Mosaic law, whatever you want to interpret it as, is anything you think you need to do or not do to make God happy or stop him from being sad, outside of or alongside of the finished work of Christ. Outside of or alongside of the finished work of Christ, just as I fix my speaker up. The commandment again, the Mosaic law, is anything you think you need to do or not do to make God happy or stop him from being sad. And when you try and do that, sin seizes its opportunity through that mindset and has the now stealth potential to completely recalibrate your mind and thinking at that moment when it breaks through to produce every kind of evil desire. In this case specifically, Paul uses covetousness. The point I'm trying to make, and this is what many people don't understand, that sin does have ways of getting opportunity over us. A lot of people, you'll hear the criminals say, I don't know what made me do it. I'm showing you what made you do it, your inner sinful nature, which you have in you. I don't care if you think you've got one or not, you've got one, and it can seize your mind, and you won't even know it. Sin can spring to life through the commandments. This is a religious empowerment of sin. This is why a lot of religious people hit the wall. Sin comes to life, springs to life through the commandment, and your mind will die at that point. Now, it doesn't stay that way. It strikes, and then it goes stealth again. It's like a snake that jumps out of a hole and bites you and then goes back into the hole again. It's a stealth operation. It will accomplish what it wants to accomplish, and that is to destroy who you are and everything about you. Paul discovered, this is the New Testament, that the commandment that was meant to bring life actually brought death. Now, a lot of Jewish people, I'm sorry, I do apologize, but I believe this. I've seen it in action throughout the Western world, that sin actually does bring death to the believer one way or another when they think there are things that they can do to make God happy or stop him from being sad outside of or alongside of the finished work of Christ. Sin again seizes his opportunity. How? Through the commandment. And one of the proofs of this is when good people are deceived into doing evil. It'll put your good intention to death and deceive you into doing all manner of evil. Sin needs to be exposed. Unless it comes to your attention in your mind, you won't even believe you have sin. But through the commandment, which was the reason why it was given, it was brought that sin might be exposed as sin, and it produces death in us through that which is good. See, the law and the commandment are holy and good. They show us a moral way of life. But that moral way of life is not successfully maintained, be it mentally, psychologically, spiritually, by adhering to it. It's impossible. But it's holy and it's righteous, it's good. The problem's not the law. Unfortunately, the problem is our sinful nature. Through the commandment, sin becomes utterly sinful. So if you want to follow the commandment, do it at your peril. Just remember, a lot of this sin is covert. You don't even know that these people have it or are experiencing it, and we've all got it. It's not them and us, it's all of us. And I'm giving us individual enlightenment in the religious way in which this overtakes us, deceives us, and causes us to do evil. There's many a good man gone down at the hand of their sinful nature that you would never have picked. Another, here's a quick one here. This is profound. Paul says, "For what I want to do, I do not do. But what I hate, that I do." Many of you make up your mind about something, and you really want to do it, and all of a sudden you're going in the opposite direction and you're struggling as to why. That's a crack, that's a chink in the armor. Your sinful nature has caused you to go in a different direction and you can't explain it, but I am for you. And if I do what I do not want to do, I admit that the law is good. And in that case, it is no longer I who do it, but my sinful nature that lives within me does it. And if you want to take this lightly, you go right ahead, but you can take it lightly without me. I'm not buying into this rubbish that, you know, this, I don't even know what you'd call it. We have a sinful nature in us. Let's go to Ephesians just quickly as we close. Ephesians chapter 4. Give me chapter 4, please. Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 22. You need to put to death your former way of life, your old self, which is being corrupted by deceitful desires. Guess what that is? That's your sinful nature working in you to deceive you. By bringing deceitful desires, things that are lustful and wrong, but the sinful nature gives you a sense that they're desirable. That's how evil works. It makes evil look desirable. They are darkened in their understanding and alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in us due to the hardness of our hearts. Guess what that ignorance is? That's our sinful nature. And we are being corrupted by its deceitful lusts, is another translation. There's one more passage before I close that I think is worthy of mention before we go. The sting of death is sin. Fair enough. Death's proof that we have a sinful nature. You can argue with that, but when you're on your deathbed, I'm sure there's somebody I know that you'll be singing out to that otherwise you wouldn't, and it's usually God. But the power of sin is what? What's the power of sin? The law. The things we think we need to do or not do to make God happy or stop him from being sad. I'm Reverend Dr. J.W. Morrison, theologist, Central Coast, New South Wales, Australia. Thank you for joining me, and bye for now.